Happy Sunday rolling out. This is your host, Christal Jordan. And I know you're not used to seeing me on a Sunday, but we have a very special conversation and we've partnered with the Black Women's Health Imperative on a conversation that is so important for us as African-American women and just our community in, as a whole. So before we get started, I want to go ahead and play this video by the Black Women's Health Imperative. And then I'm gonna bring in some very special guests. You guys definitely don't wanna miss out on this. Stay right there. If you're in front of your computer, if you're on your phone, you don't wanna stop. You wanna make sure that you're tuned into this conversation. I've got some amazing ladies and some great information coming soon. And we're just gonna have a sister girl talk like we always do right here on Reality Check. Like I said, this is a very special Reality Check, which is why I'm coming to you on a Sunday on National HIV Testing Day, no doubt, for a great conversation. So check out this video and I'll be right back.
Thank you for joining us. You are a part of an elite group who recognizes that Black women's health should be at the forefront of the national conversation. We are mothers, daughters, activists, entrepreneurs, entertainers, corporate warriors, and more, who help boost the economy and often drive the national conversation. For 38 years, the Black Women's Health Imperative has strived to amplify our voices, help enact policy that protects us, research our issues, create programs that enhance our lives, and produce events like this one to ensure we keep the conversation going about the issues that matter to us most. So, let's get started with our program.
All right. As I said, Rolling Out is excited to partner. We've partnered before, but especially on today with the Black Women's Health Imperative. And that brings me to my beautiful guest for today. I have Dr. Andrea Dunn. She is the founder of Less Beehive, an HIV advocacy group for women and children. They've done some amazing work in Florida. And she is joined by the very beautiful Eva Marcille. We know that she has skyrocketed from being America's top model to actress, mother, advocate, model, all the above, and one of our favorite cover models. So welcome, Eva Marcille.
Thank you so much for having me, Christal. I appreciate the time.
Absolutely. Well, Dr. Dunn, I mentioned we first started this. This was important for us to do today because it is National HIV Testing Day. Can you talk a little bit about why it's so important for us to be aware of this, especially as Black women?
Of course. Today is, you know, really important because for Black women, they actually represent, they're 15 times more likely to contract HIV than any other race. And so right now it's so important for Black women to be involved and a part of getting tested for HIV, just like we would if it was for any other health conditions. And honestly, it should be normalized, just like we check our blood pressure, check cholesterol, and just any other annual test that we should be doing. And so it's very important for Black women to be involved in this conversation. Very, very important.
Well, we know that it's like a Sunday, and it's also, we've got BET Awards, people are doing things outside, but it is really important for us to actually come together on this day because of that. But the conversation really is evergreen. It's something that we always need to be talking about.
Absolutely.
It seems like we have kind of, you know, gotten away from that, especially coming out of COVID. We don't hear people being really concerned about contracting HIV. Why do you guys think that this is kind of taken a back burner, just everything else that we have going on in our plates? I'll start with you, Eva. How do you think that this COVID and everything that we've been dealing with has kind of distracted us from our health concerns?
Absolutely. I think with COVID and the pandemic being so immediate, it has put a back burner on all kind of health issues, not just HIV and AIDS, but the elderly, the poverty issues. You know, you see them skyrocket. I'm in Los Angeles and I'm passing by areas that I am just amazed to see because the conditions have changed so drastically with everything that's going on. You know, speaking of the BET Awards, usually at this time, LA Live does this big a weekend extravaganza. And one of the things we focus on this specific day is HIV and AIDS testing. And we do different initiatives. I remember one year we did a cash grab. And I had like Snoop Dogg and all these different entertainers come by and talk about the importance of just knowing your status. You know, I remember the first time I ever even heard of it was 95 when Eazy-E was reporting contracted it. And then again in 96 with Magic Johnson. So it became a little bit more normalized as far as speaking out, because obviously it was an epidemic and something that we have been dealing with. But I think the importance of today and even those times are having the courage to talk about it so that we can do something about it. And
exactly.
Like we said.
Exactly. You know, honestly, Black women, I love the what you mentioned, Eva, but Black women, we represent the highest proportion of women. When you look at just, you know, the female gender, Black women have consistently been higher than any other race as far as being diagnosed with HIV. And so over the years, we've actually had some declines, but consistently Black women have always been the highest to be disproportionately affected by HIV and AIDS. And so,
but, you know, if you want to be honest on this good Sunday and the day of the Lord, Black women have disproportionately been at the bottom in healthcare all the way across the board. So not just HIV and AIDS. But when it comes to fibroids, when it comes to childbirth, when it comes to death at childbirth, like Black women across the board systematically have been put at the bottom of the totem pole. So it is not an unlikely statistic that we are in the higher number of those that don't know and contract, because we're in the highest number that don't know and contract across the board medically.
I definitely agree with that, Eva. That, and I think sometimes that it can almost make you kind of numb to hearing the statistics, because every time we hear something, we are always disproportionately affected. But I want to talk a little bit about our culture and how we view things. So I wanted to ask the both of you. I'm going to start with you, Dr. Dunn. What was your first conversation like about sex? When we think about how we teach our daughters, how we talk to our little sisters, you know, what those conversations are like. Can you share what that first conversation that you can recall was about sex?
I would say, honestly, because we didn't have the internet and all of this stuff, I didn't have, you know, we couldn't talk about it in my household. My mom was not having it. There was no conversations about sex. No movies, nothing. So honestly, I would say high school, almost college, before we really got into like deep conversations about sex, just honestly speaking.
Wow.
Yeah, we did not get any sex education in school, nothing.
Wow. So was sexual health a part of that conversation, or that was just the birds and the bees? Was the sexual health a part of that?
Honestly, with getting my menstrual cycle, that was probably the closest that I got from home. But everything else came from friends.
Right.
From friends. And I would say high school.
Eva, what about you?
Mine was different. Middle school, there was that sex ed health elective that your parents could like sign that paper. And that meant you can go in there and learn about the birds and the bees, so to say. So they gave you like the minimal foundation that women had reproductive organs. They prepped you about, you know, there is a thing called a menstrual cycle. Some women get it, or young ladies get it earlier. And so for me, that was kind of the precursor conversation to things that I didn't understand. So I went home like, so when you got this menstrual, what are you supposed to do? So that's how it kind of started, was in sex ed. But I can say the more extensive conversation were the ignorant ones amongst my friends that were also in sex ed, that learned what we thought we knew from, you know, Skinamax TV and workout.
So, guys, I think that's most of our experiences. I remember talking to my mother was a nurse, so I got a lot of sex health conversations, but it really wasn't about this is what you should do. It's like, okay, make sure that you're safe. But like that, it takes a total different, actually hearing that and understanding how to implement that at a one-on-one with your partner is a little bit different. So I want to ask you guys both, why do you think that there is such a disconnect with women with actually hearing about sex, talking about sex? Because I think differently than when we were growing up, I think that there is like a feeling of sexual liberation, but I think women still struggle with actually speaking up when it comes to HIV testing. Like I don't, you know, asking someone else their status is not considered it seems like an uncomfortable situation. There's not a lot of women comfortable actually asking a man. Women ask him how much money he makes. They ask him, you know, what kind of car does he drive? But asking him, does he know his HIV status, is something that's considered a little bit taboo. Dr. Dunn, where do you think that disconnect comes from?
It's a stigma, just quite frankly, and the fact that no one wants to talk about it. And honestly, I feel like it has been almost like a generational thing because sex was always shunned, I feel like, for so long in the older generation. And so when you start to engage in sexual activities, I think naturally you feel liberated because it's something that you weren't, I guess, technically supposed to do. Wow. But as far as having the conversation, you know, I feel like there's so much stigma that if you bring it up, then you must have it, or you must think I have it, or so people may get offended by asking that question. And I think a lot of women may be afraid of rejection, but to be honest with you, they have to have enough confidence in themselves. And I think it's a factor of if they are fearful of that, you know, that it's maybe some insecurities that they may have to deal with. It should be no different than any other conversation, but it's so much stigma associated with HIV that I think that is one of the biggest drivers for why people don't do it, as opposed to trying to have that conversation up front and then, you know, maybe setting standards or trying to figure out what you have to do from that point on, depending on how they respond to those questions. But, you know, if you can't have that conversation, you probably shouldn't be having sex with that person anyway.
Yeah.
So
I like that stigma too. It's attached to shame. I remember when COVID first became prevalent and people found out about COVID. So, you know, if you had allergies and you cough twice, you're like, you got the Rona, watch out. Everyone was scared because we created a stigma and a shame behind having COVID. And so I think that analogy is transferable when you talk about HIV, AIDS, testing, questioning, and knowing your status, is that there has been a shame attached to that information, which does not motivate people to have the conversation. Not because it's not necessary, but the fear of the judgment, the fear of the shame. And I think, you know, that's why today is so important, and this organization is so important, because, you know, taking the shame out of it, you know, even like having Hep C, so many veterans that went to Vietnam contracted Hep C. It is a reality. Uh-huh. And I think when the shame was taken off of it, and you realize that this is a lifelong situation and we're going to deal with it, you're going to flourish and live a beautiful life, but we're going to take the "it's your fault, it's a problem" part out. Mm-hmm. I think when we successfully do that in the community as Black women and take the shame part out, because we talk about alopecia, we talk about not having edges and throwing on a wig, like there's so many other things that we can shun from. But I think the importance of this is our health. And it's the difference between life and death, literally knowing your status. Not being infected, but not knowing your status is your death sentence. And so just taking the shame off of it and knowing what you need to do to take care of you is, that's the flex.
Right.
And we have to make that the flex, not the shame.
I love that, Eva. Well, if you guys are just joining, we are having a special edition version of Reality Check. This is a real reality check because it is about life or death. We're talking about this on National HIV Testing Day. There are at the bottom of your screen, you'll see hashtag own your ish, also hashtag NHTD, and of course, rolling out and Black women's health. This is a partnership conversation between rolling out and Black women's health imperative. So please, if you have conversations or comments to add to the discussion, you can do them on Instagram, Twitter, and make sure you hashtag own your ish. Eva brought up some great points, and I kind of want to piggyback on that, because at one point in time, women talking about their own sexuality was considered taboo. That was considered, you know, we didn't want to admit that we actually enjoy sex. And I think that there's been a movement for younger women. They're very open. Mm-hmm. You know, Cardi, Meg, the City Girls, everybody.
Willow.
Everybody's talking about sex, and they're talking about it in a very They've taken control of their own sexuality. And I think while we applaud that part, there's obviously this part is missing, you know, out of that. If we can have WAP and kind of that could be on mainstream, you know, television and on the radio, and we can talk about how women are able to take back their sexuality, then why aren't we also talking about the fact that we need to be safe as we're doing that? Where do you guys think that disconnect is between the younger generation being very, very in your face with their sexuality and, you know, kind of daring, you know, men to say anything about it, but yet still not making sure that that conversation about their sexual health is a part of that? I'll start with you, Dr. Dunn.
Honestly, that's a loaded question, but I will say, you know, let me see, I'm trying to figure out how can I phrase this without being so technical, but, you know, honestly, women should feel empowered about having sex. They should. But I feel like, honestly, there's two sides to this that no one really talks about, because there's consequences to having sex too. And no one is really shedding a light on pregnancies or sexually transmitted infections. So it's almost like it's a two-sided coin or double-edged sword sometimes, because there are consequences to having sex. Even though it is meant to be pleasurable, enjoyable, and it's something that eventually everybody's going to experience it in life. And so I think removing that stigma, as Eva mentioned, and also making it to where it's more normalized. And so that's what I feel like society and music and all these things that we see, they're trying to normalize it. But honestly, I feel like sometimes it can also be embellished, where I feel like Black women or women of color are just judged and based on their body type and their image and their butt and their breast, and it's so much. So it's like the music is good and it's empowering, but then again, I feel like for our younger generation and population, it's almost damaging them sometimes at the same time too, because they have no level of respect for sex and the intimacy and the mental effects that can happen if you engage in sex too early, if that makes, you know, a lot of sense. So it's a good thing, and I get it, but at the same time, I feel like it's sending the wrong message too.
I think it has to do with appropriateness and age and time. Mm-hmm. I think all things in time, even my daughter, I remember when buying her first things, I bought her animals and teddy bears before I bought her Barbie dolls, just to give her a time to stay innocent and to not have to question and wonder why this was different than that. And so when it comes to the younger generation, when it comes to women as a whole, the entire reason for women's liberation in the movement is to take back what is ours, which is our body, our mind, our ability to choose, to free think, to not be just a house mother, to also be a CEO and, you know, domesticated, and to be all of those things. And so I think it more so has to do with just understanding your power as a woman. But when you're young, you're still a kid. You don't drink beer because you're a kid. You don't do kid things. And so I think the cross is no different than Tina Turner and the music that they listened to back in the day. Let's Get It On, right? But you didn't have your kid on the way to school singing Let's Get It On, which is the same reason why you shouldn't have your kid on the way to school singing WAP. You know, I think we give music a hard time talking about the exploitedness of sex in it, where I can say Smokey was a lot more clever about talking about his affairs and his music, but it was no different. And he spoke nothing of using protection. You know, you didn't have them talking about Shirley Murdoch didn't go sleep with someone's husband and then go back and say, and I made sure I was protected. So I think, like you said, it's a loaded question, because I don't think the two are analogous. I think it is proper when those artists then use their platform and show monogamy in their relationship and healthy sexual experiences in their lifestyles, be it a condom on the side of the bed in the music video or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Because you see that part too. And I think that's more so where the artist finds their responsibility. And then you have an artist like me that uses my platform to talk a little bit more extensively about how it has affected me and why it's so important to me. But I think everyone does their part in their way. You know what I mean? And I think it has gotten not where we should be, but we're not where we were.
Right. Well, I like to think that women are comfortable at least talking about things that are that are important to them. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, we see that conversation has started because it's really important for us to own our sexuality as women. And once we own it, then, then the next step can be to make sure that we're taking those steps. So Dr. Dunn, you mentioned, you know, there are consequences for sex. There are preventative things. We think about pregnancy, and we know that there is the option for birth control, and there's several options for that. We think about HIV. I know that there are different things on the market, but I don't think people are really aware, at least in our community, as African-American women, we don't see a lot of women really knowledgeable about like the PrEP drug and things like that. So can you talk a little bit about PrEP and why maybe our community was not as aware or doesn't have the education about that that drug like maybe we need to?
Yes, PrEP is an acronym for pre-exposure prophylaxis. It's a long term, but essentially what it means is preventing HIV before it can happen. Right. So something like you mentioned, very similar to birth control. But a lot of people in our community, they don't really know about it because they don't, even though it was approved for use back in 2014, we didn't see any advertisements for it for a long time, And then they really got a lot of backlash because they felt like a lot of they were going to increase the rates of other sexually transmitted diseases if we were to be able to prevent HIV, because I think a lot of times people want to use condoms for pregnancy big time or for big STDs like HIV that aren't curable. Uh-huh. And, you know, what's the sad part about it is they started this out and it was only advertised when they did start advertising it for gay males. And it was more specifically Caucasian gay men. And so this is how they were able to reduce their rates in other populations over a longer period of time, because PrEP uptake is more common among Caucasian gay men. Mm-hmm. When it comes to Black people, for a long time, we didn't see anything that was from us, for us, about us that could help prevent this disease within our population. And that's one of the things with Let's Beehive that we're really trying to do, as well as organizations and platforms like this, is to help get the awareness out as far as what is the news about this HIV prevention pill. And so the technical word or drug name for it is Truvada, and it's Truvada for PrEP. And you can take it once a day. So right now, the very first formulation of it has been pill form. It's very similar to how birth control first started, one pill once a day. Mm-hmm. And then now we're starting to see a lot of research where it can develop. And, you know, there's research now for injectable PrEP. And this is specifically for people who are negative. There's also research being done now very similar to like NuvaRing, like birth control, and they have a device that's, you know, implanted or a ring that's going to help do the same thing that NuvaRing would do, but just with the anti-HIV medication. And so they're developing a lot of new things, but right now the only thing that we have available is the once a day pill in pill form. And so there's a new formulation of PrEP called Descovy, which is almost like a sister or a cousin to Truvada. But the sad part about it is it's not approved for women right now. And one of the biggest contributing factors was because there was no research for women in a long time. So they didn't really know the effects of how this drug would respond or react and if there was true efficacy for women. And so for in the beginning, and so after years and years of research, now they actually have benefits for Truvada for PrEP. So that's the only one that's approved right now currently for women, and women still don't know. And then if they do know about it, I think there's a level of medical mistrust that still is, you know, still in existence, and we're still fighting that. And, you know, a lot of people just may not see themselves or feel like this is something that's for them. Uh-huh. You know, and they feel like, and this is something we see even out in community outreach and out on the ground and just trying to talk to different women, because women and children are two of our target populations. And a lot of people don't perceive themselves to be at risk. Mm-hmm. Even as a Black woman living in a geographical area where there are high rates of HIV, and even with the education and the information, sometimes they still are hesitant to learn more information about PrEP because it's another form. And that's honestly how birth control started out years ago too. And we've been able to normalize that. And now it's like second nature to start birth control. And what we're really hoping that we can see is that a lot of women will do birth control in addition to PrEP to help protect themselves to stay negative. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the big things that we are, you know, focusing on with PrEP and the prevention pill, because it's very effective and it works. We just have to get on it.
Right.
So is your thought process around that women across the board should be investing in taking PrEP, or at least learning more about it across the board? Is there a certain percentage or a certain demographic that you think should we start our girls young, like when they're on birth control? Like how should we be looking at applying PrEP to our daily lives, you know, lifestyles and how we take medicine and how we look at preventative measures?
Those are really good questions. Honestly, right now, PrEP can be used in teenagers as young as 13, but honestly, it depends on their weight and how big they are and the closer they are to adult-sized children. But basically, you can start them as young as 15, 16 years old, especially if you know your child may be LGBTQ+, and you want to help prevent any, you know, HIV infection, then they can take PrEP just like anybody else can. And I think a lot of times with our youth, we have to get parents involved with that. But for young women, college women, you know, even women my age and, you know, and up, it's definitely something that we should talk about more and help normalize those conversations about PrEP, because it is effective for preventing HIV if used correctly, up to 94% at preventing HIV. So why is it that Black women, if we're mostly affected by HIV and highest for new diagnosis, but there's a tool out there that's available to help reduce HIV, but there's only 7% right now of Black women who have actually been prescribed and actually taken PrEP, 7%. And they've estimated that about 500,000 African-Americans could benefit from PrEP, and we could actually reduce the rates of new cases of HIV in several populations if we would just, you know. So there's several initiatives to try to give PrEP for free to populations who are at risk. And it's just, you know, something that we have to do in things like this. And I'm super excited to, you know, be here even with Eva to have these conversations about this, because I think it takes people in different areas and different platforms to help get this message out as much as we can to show people how important it is and that, you know, we're here to help and there's resources available.
Absolutely. I'm gonna ask you guys, start with you, Evie, because you talked about like the idea that there are, you know, first of all, there's a lot of medical mistrust in our community. And we have to say for good reason. We have there's a lot of information and things that have happened in the past that have kind of contributed to us having medical mistrust. So I think platforms like these where we can see us talking to us are so important. One of the reasons that we're so excited to partner with Black Women's Health Imperative, because it's important for us to speak to us. But there's also the idea of what I don't know won't hurt me, especially in our community. It's like, I don't want to know. I remember my grandmother used to say, I don't know and I don't want to know. And sometimes, most of the time, not knowing hurts you worse, whether it's, you know, cancer prevention, HIV, the longer you don't know your status, the more damage it can do to your health. So I want to ask you, I'm gonna start with Eva, what advice would you give to a woman that, you know, has never been tested for HIV and is really afraid? There's that fear of, you know, what if I am positive and what does that mean? I have no idea. That fear of unknowing is usually worse than the actual reality of something. So what would be your advice to someone that just doesn't, is afraid to know the truth?
Man up. Man up. You know, I think the whole what I don't know doesn't hurt me. It comes from, and I think we also have to remember as we, I don't want to say judge, but as we look at the Black community as far as our progress and our knowledge of healthcare, this country is not designed for us. Healthcare is not designed to enrich our lives. It is designed to help keep us at the bottom. And so I think, you know, as Black women, we have been taught by grandmother, who's been taught by her grandmother, that we are survivors. We thrive, we have contracted, we have figured it out. And so I think there's this idea of we've succeeded before, or we've got through, at least seemingly enough, that we're okay. And as Black women, you know, I think it's a large debate now dividing the Black man and alpha man and strong Black women. That's a whole nother discussion for a whole nother day, because we're up in a minute. But I think that the fear a lot, or a lot of times the women not needing to feel a sense of urgency, is because we as a whole Black women from London to South Central Los Angeles have been the pillars of the community and the backbone, lived with lupus our whole life, had no clue, lived with this our whole life and had no clue, only to know that grandma or auntie would have lived longer and healthier had she had a clue.
Right.
But we've done so well as a people to show face, or to save face rather, despite what we are going through medically. And so education, and to know that, baby girl, you don't have to be in pain. You don't have to be in fear. You don't have to be out of the know. And you can be healthy and still go. And I think that is literally a new idea for this generation, because the generations past that taught us that if you still here, you okay.
Right.
You know, if you know what I mean? It's like, mm-hmm. No, that's not really the best message.
Right.
It's how we got through.
Right.
And it was a necessary message when it was necessary. But I think now with knowledge, with access, gives us the power to not have that as our reality anymore.
Very well said. Dr. Dunn?
Yeah, we can no longer stay silent about a lot of these things, or for that matter, continue to be ignorant. You know, sometimes I feel like there's a sense of where we want to ignore what's going on, because it's easier to ignore it than face it. In this case, ignorance is not bliss. It's better to know than it is to, you know, than not know. Uh-huh. And you don't want to put yourself at risk for that. You know, so I think there's a lot of, you know, there's a big move for self-love. And this is an area where you have to think about yourself first and love yourself first to make sure that what you're doing is going to be good. So it's a matter of, you know, own your ish. You got to worry about you first. And then who are you, you know, engaging with, sleeping with, and making sure that, you know, you can be strong enough to have these tough conversations before you engage in these types of activities. So I think, you know, we're definitely moving in the right direction. And like I mentioned before, we are seeing a decline in new rates of African-American women, but we're still at the top. And so, you know, we still got a lot of work to do. And with the advances of medication and virtual education platforms like this, we can definitely continue to spread the word and help increase awareness about these issues.
Absolutely. I know, Eva, I want to ask her one last question before we let her go. You have a daughter, your beautiful daughter, Marley, that we've seen growing up. And I want to ask you, what do you plan to teach her? What do you think your first conversation, if you haven't already had one?
I have no clue. Honestly, I can't tell you. My daughter is 7. My youngest is 1. And my middle child is 3. I learn every day new ways of parenting. There's no rule book. I believe that when the time comes, God is very good at giving me the words necessary in the moment. But I, even having been an advocate of the community for my entire teenage and adult life, I have no clue to what I will say yet to my 7-year-old daughter, who barely understands the difference between her body parts and boys' body parts. But I definitely won't make it shameful. That I can tell you. Just like drinking alcohol and smoking weed, you do it when you're grown. You can't drive a car as a kid. You know, so all things in due time, but I have no clue what that conversation is going to be.
Very honest answer. Well, I know, like I said, I know you've got 1,000 things on your plate, Eva. Thank you so much for joining us. You had some great gems to drop. I think that baby girl, you can be okay.
I'm going to send it to you. That's what I'm going to do.
I'm slaying it right to the beehive. Okay. Yes, ma'am. We have a program for parents. So I was just going to tell you that we can definitely do that and provide that service for you.
I'm honest, and sometimes it's to my fault, but I wouldn't even lie and try to make up what I would say. I don't know. So please give me your handbook. I will give you my address. Let me know where I can order it.
Yes, ma'am.
That's all a part of that village.
Me, and it's such a pleasure, Dr. Dunn and Christal Jordan, so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for rolling out.
All right, we're going to let you go. That actually, to help people to have that conversation, Black Women's Health Imperative put out a PSA today that actually stars Keisha Knight Pulliam. So we're going to play that really quickly, but that's, you know, I think it takes a village to raise children and also to influence children. So again, programs like these, conversations like these, I think are helpful to mothers. I remember not knowing what to tell my daughter, not knowing what to do with that conversation. So these are the type of platforms that we need as women to support each other. So I want to play the PSA with featuring Keisha Knight Pulliam, and then we'll have some last words with Dr. Dunn.
You own every room you walk into. You live with no regrets, and you own your decisions. I see you doing your thing, sis. You own your ish. But you can't stop there. You gotta own your sexual health too. If COVID taught us anything, is that we should be beyond playing games when it comes to our health. We have a right to advocate for ourselves. But what does that even look like? It looks like not believing you know everything about the one you're with. It looks like keeping your entire prevention routine on lock. Condoms, absolutely. PrEP, daily. But we can't forget about getting tested and asking about status. So before you even think about getting with them, think about you. Look, you don't want to have this conversation with yourself later. Go to onourownterms.bwhi.org for more information.
All right, I don't think we could have said it any better.
I know, that was such an amazing video. She was right on. She hit the head on a lot of different things, you know, because we have to take care of ourselves. It's all about us owning our ish. We have to take care of ourselves.
Absolutely. If we don't do it and stand up for ourselves and teach ourselves how to do it, it won't happen, because we see with our numbers being higher consistently, that's not going to change unless we as Black women stand up and make that change. Dr. Dunn, can you give any last minute words for women out there that, you know, HIV, taking an HIV test may not be a priority for them? They may be thinking, oh, I know my partner, I'm with someone who I trust him, or I know what he's doing, and I'm sure I'm safe. Any last minute words for us to share with our viewers that may be feeling this doesn't affect them?
Yes, I think, you know, women, you have to take a stance for yourself. Even if you are in a committed relationship, you can't justify what you're doing and assume that that's what your partner is doing. You have to take ownership for your own safety and actually plug in, you know, the importance of couples getting tested. You know, there's a lot of home self kits that BWHI is working with a different lab to provide this service. And it's so important for people, if you don't feel comfortable going out to a physical place or going to a mobile unit, there are home test kits that you can take with your partner in the comfort of your own home. And this is something that we have recommended even throughout the stretch for COVID-19 in order to continue the initiative for testing while people are home. And so it's really going to be interesting to see how COVID is going to affect the rates of HIV in the next year or so when the data for 2020 is available, because right now it's not complete. And so it's just, you know, you have to take ownership for you and not make assumptions, because there are, you know, chances of infidelities. That's one of the biggest reasons why people break up, between infidelity and money, whether you're married or in a committed relationship or not. And I think this is a myth and a misconception that a lot of women have, and a lot of women have that lack of perception. If they don't perceive themselves to be at risk, then how can they protect themselves, or how could they even want to protect themselves from something that they may not realize is there?
Right.
And another one really big point is I like to let women know is, how can you protect yourself from something that you can't see? Uh-huh. HIV doesn't have a look. And with the advances of medicine, it's so important for people to realize that, you know, that there's no real look for HIV, and that there's people who are living and thriving, living with HIV, living healthy lives. They're living longer, you know, bearing children. And you know, women are very strong, powerful beings. And so are men. You know, together, we can definitely make a change. And together, I really feel like we can make a difference by just having that conversation and getting tested with your partner, and being okay with the test results if they come back. You know, if you're sleeping with someone or sharing needles with someone and you're not protecting yourself, then it's something that I feel like it's good to know than not know, so that way you can get in care and get the medication and things that you need in order to live a longer life.
Absolutely. In most situations, the fear of not knowing, the fear of something is actually more detrimental to us than the actual thing, right? So getting your results, it puts you in a position of power so that you're able to take care of yourself. So I want to thank you, Dr. Dunn, for joining me. I want to make sure that everybody out there knows that on behalf of BWHI, they are giving away free HIV testing kits. And I don't, you know, we've got to make this norm. We've got to normalize this. We've got to have conversations with our partners. Taking the test together can be one of those things that, you know, draws you all closer. So make sure that you go and visit onourownterms.bwhi.org. And you can use the offer code NTD2021. BWHI to get your free kit while supplies last. I want to thank everyone for joining us today and listening to this very important conversation. I know we like to talk about gossip. We like to talk about all that celebrity stuff, but this is so important because this is our health. This is our health and this is our legacy. You know, we can't move forward and do all the amazing things that we see Black women doing if we're not taking care of our health and we're not taking care of our sister's health. So I thank you, Dr. Dunn, for being a leader, for doing the amazing work that you're doing and being an educator to us. And we look forward to assisting you in that fight moving forward.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. It was definitely a joy. Thank you so much.
All right. Enjoy the rest of your day.
You too.
All right. Well, I want to thank you guys for joining again. You see there, if you want to be a part of this conversation, you can use the hashtag #OwnYourIsh and also hashtag NHTD. Remember, you can go to onourownterms.bwhi.org for that free testing kit. And like I said, make that something that you do with your partner. We do better as a team. And so having those hard conversations can only draw you closer. If you're not in a relationship, doing that for yourself is the best form of self-care. So we want to encourage you all to do that. Happy Sunday. Happy National AIDS HIV Testing Sunday. We hope that you all are well. Again, we thank you for joining us and Black Women's Health Imperative. And until next time, this is your host, Christal Jordan. And I'm reminding you to enjoy, take care of yourself, love yourself, and always put yourself first. I'll see you guys tomorrow right back here for Reality Check at 8 p.m.